my surrender. This is my surrender. Here is where I lay it down. Every lie and every doubt. This is my surrender. And I will make room for you to do whatever you want to. 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 Here is where I lay it down. Every burden, every crown. This is my surrender. This is my surrender. Here is where I lay it down. Every lie and every doubt. This is my surrender. And I will make room for you. To whatever you want to. To do whatever you want to. And I will make room for you. To do whatever you want to. To do whatever you want to. Shake up the ground of all my tradition. Break down. To do whatever you want to. To do whatever you want to. And I will make room for you. To do whatever you want to. To do whatever you want to. Here is where I lay it down. You are all I'm chasing now. This is my surrender. How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, Father turns His face away, as wounds which mother chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man. How great is
Let your name Good morning, all, and welcome to Messy Church. Has everybody had a good breakfast?
Yep.
Okay, a couple of notices, Linda.
I don't know if I'm the right person to be doing this because Sarah's here. On Friday night, Sarah and Rosemary and Sean and Nikki and the boys slept out in Alice Park. And I don't think they could have possibly imagined when they got there on Friday night. I had a text, actually, Rosemary thought my phone would be off, but it was on. So I had a text at 4 o'clock with that photograph, and she said, "It's very cold." Anyway, they did it. Oh, about 100 people, apparently. Is that right, Sarah? About 100 of you did it all night. I said, "Will you be able to go early?" And she said, "No, the boys will want to stay for their muffins at 7 o'clock. So I know lots of you have already sponsored them, and Fliss has the sponsor forms. So if she'll probably come around today and ask you if you would like to give her that money. But thank you very much. And, you know, we have to think, don't we? They did it for one night, and it was very cold. Some people do it every night. Thank you.
And then from Nick, could everybody please return their, whatever this is called, forgotten already. Whatever Nick says, that would be great. Okay, so I have the pleasure of saying over to you, David, and to the Messy Church team.
Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome. This morning, as well as being Messy Church Breakfast, it is the first Sunday in the month, and so that means we celebrate birthdays today. So if you have a birthday in March, come and join me up here now.
Come on then. Come on, but...
So we got one or two birthdays. So Rupert, when's your birthday?
March the 23rd.
23rd, and how old are you going to be?
Seven.
Seven, fantastic. Right, well, have a chocolate. There we go. Wonderful. Well, oh, Val's sneaking in behind us. Right, okay. So, we're obviously going from youngest to oldest here. So, Val, when's your birthday?
19th.
And how old are you going to be?
88.
No. Yeah. Well, don't look a day over 90. There you go. Katie, when's your birthday?
21st.
And...
37.
That's not what Evie says. Fantastic. Yes. So Claire, when's your birthday?
26th. I mean, 20 years older than Katie.
Really? No. That's unbelievable. Fantastic. Thank you. Nick, when's your birthday?
30th of March.
And how old are you going to be?
37.
Wow. Yeah. Fantastic. There you go. So Ian, when's your birthday?
6th of March.
And?
52.
Ooh. A youngster, mere youngster. And, oh, let's come to Joyce on the end. Joyce, when's your birthday?
The 9th.
And how old are you going to be?
92.
No way, fantastic. There you go. And we come to today's birthday boy. Yay! Alex, it is your birthday today. So how old are you now then?
I am 52.
Wow, fantastic. Have a chocolate. There we go. Well done. Let's bless them all and sing.
Happy birthday to you. God loves all of you.
So, our messy breakfast this month. It's great to see so many people turning up for breakfast this morning and come to join in exploring all sorts of wonderful things that we shall be looking at later on in our service and in the activities that we've got going on out in the schoolroom in a little while. We're going to be focusing this morning on what it means to be a worshipper of God and the sort of things that we need to have in our minds when we come to worship God and to explore these things in all sorts of different ways. So we're going to sing together a couple of songs that help us draw together in worship and focus ourselves upon God. So I invite you, if you're able, to stand as we join together in these first two songs. Lord God, we thank you that you do welcome each and every one of us here this morning, no matter who we are, no matter what sort of frame of mind we've come in, whether we know you really well or we're just getting to know you, you welcome us here because you love us and we've come to celebrate that love and give thanks for it. And so we do praise and worship you for all that you are to us.
Thank you.
Please have a seat. So, some of you this morning were at breakfast preparing something that we're going to have a look at a little bit later on in the service. Lots of words to do with worship, what we're thinking about when we come to worship God. At Lighthouse on Thursday, some of the Lighthouse crew were getting something ready for us, and that's going to be added to, I think, this morning as well. We're going to be out there in the schoolroom building a temple. What else are we doing? We're making musical instruments. Have I missed anything out? Okay, I'm making musical instruments to use when we come back in together at the end of the service. Okay, so there's all sorts of things going on this morning. You can go and do some of the activities out there, or you can stay in here and you have the pleasure of listening to me. So, you're spoiled for choice this morning, and you could do a bit of both. You could start out there and then come back in here, or you could start in here and then sneak out and hope I don't notice you as you go out. No, if you want to go out halfway through, you go out halfway through and go and enjoy some of those activities out there. So let's have a listen to our reading from Scripture this morning. This is Jesus going up to Jerusalem, and he gets to the temple and he doesn't like what he sees there. So who's reading for us this morning? Felicity, lovely. Thank you.
Right, I'll try again. The reading is taken from John chapter 2, verses 13 to 22. When it was almost time for the Jewish Passover, Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple courts, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and others sitting at tables exchanging money. So he made a whip out of cords and drove all from the temple courts, both sheep and cattle. He scattered the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. To those who sold doves, he said, "Get these out of here. Stop turning my father's house into a market." His disciples remembered that this is written, that it is written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then responded to him, "What sign can you show us to prove your authority to do all this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and I will raise it again in 3 days." They replied, "It has taken 46 years to build this temple, and you are going to raise it in 3 days?" But the temple he had spoken of was his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples recalled what he'd said. Then they believed the scripture and the words that Jesus had spoken. Amen.
Right, so then, if you want to go and explore things in the schoolroom, looking at building temples, making musical instruments, and doing some graffiti, then you'd be very welcome to do so. Go and do that now, and we'll come back about 20 past, I would think. Okay. See if you can get that undone for me. Welcome, Rosemary, if you thawed out. Thought perhaps it just took you that long to get warm from Friday night. We were looking at photos of you earlier on, and you did get a round of applause as well, all of you who are there, Sarah as well. And us.
Thank you, everybody, for sponsoring Sarah and I, Sean. It's been amazing.
Wonderful. Well done. Well done. So we're looking at this whole business of Jesus turning the tables over in the temple. And it's one of those stories that you think it's so un-Jesus-like. You know, he's normally the one who's just like being the one who welcomes people, the one who accepts people, the one who gently shows them the error of their ways, rather than turning tables over, making a whip and driving animals and I suppose people as well out of the temple. And try and picture in your mind what that might have looked like. All right, this temple area is huge. It's got to be the size of at least 4 or 5 football pitches, maybe more than that. It's just like the size of the Rec down here. That big area. And that would have been a lot of it filled with all these hundreds, if not thousands, of people. And all the animals there, and all the tables and the stalls and so on. And to turn all those over and to drive all those out is a real frenzied act. It's not just to like, oh, I don't like what you're doing, turn that table off, clear off you lot. It's a real frenzied act that is going on here. And so this story that John gives to us about Jesus turning over the tables, driving out the money changers and all this sort of thing, it's dramatic, but I would suggest it's also challenging to us today about what it means to worship God. What is the nature of worship? You see, these people in the temple who were selling the animals, the people who were doing the money changing, that you could argue that they were helping other people to be able to worship God. You see, in the days of the animal sacrifice, you needed an animal to sacrifice. Well, not everybody has like a spare animal that they can bring with them to the temple to sacrifice. So you get there and you buy one. But you're only allowed to use the money that is like the temple money. So any money that you have to change it with the money changers. And then you can buy your animal. Then you can do your sacrifice, which is your proper worship to God. So there is an argument there to say that these sellers of animals, the money changers, were helping people to be able to worship God. Jesus obviously thought differently, which is why he's turning the tables over and driving everybody out. He didn't see it that way. This morning, just as we were gathering together to worship, and Jim was leading us in those songs of just helping us to focus upon God. And then as we began here at 10:30 and just singing a couple of very simple songs, I just felt my spirit soaring. I don't know about you. There is a real sense of God is moving in this place. God is moving in my life. God is moving in the lives of the people I see singing these songs and just delighting in that. I'd like to think I place a very high value on our corporate acts of worship. You see, I think they're probably the single most important thing we do as a church together. I think here in our acts of worship is where everything that is good about this church has its roots, has its origin. If we're not first and foremost a worshiping people, if our heart is not bent towards God in worship, then we can't possibly hope to understand what God requires of us as a church in terms of our service, of our witness, our mission. It's a bit like, you know, ringing somebody up, ringing a friend up, and assuming before you ring them, you know everything they're going to say, so you don't bother ringing them in the first place. Our worship here this morning is about singing and praising God, listening to his word, and it's a two-way conversation. We send up our praises to God, we listen for his word coming to us in all sorts of different ways, whether that be through scripture, whether that be through the sermon, whether that be through the spaces where there's a moment of silence or in anything else that we do, in our prayers and so on. It's here that everything that is good about this church has its roots, which is why it's so important for us to worship God in spirit and truth. Not to worship God in our latest favourite song or favourite old hymn, not to worship God in a particular set pattern or way, not to think, well, this is a Methodist church, so it has to be a Methodist sort of way, whatever that might be, or any other church that we happen to belong to, but only to worship God in spirit and truth. Because then what comes out of our being together and worshipping God together is God's spirit and truth guiding us beyond this hour or so that we are together. It's here that we remain connected together as one to the vine. It's here that the fruitfulness begins. It's here that we receive our commission from God in how to serve him. In other words, how to be the church. I'm saying this in terms of our corporate nature. Each of us have to do that separately for ourselves, and that might be here on a Sunday morning, it might be away from here, but together, this is what we're about. And there's all sorts of ways we can think about worship and what it is. In some ways, it's a mirror of heaven. I remember some years ago, there's a young girl in church with her mum, and we were singing a song in that particular church. I think it might have actually been The Splendor of the King, How Great is Our God. And apparently, after we'd finished singing this song, this little girl said to her mum, I've got like a tingling feeling in my spine. You know, I've just got this shudder in my spine from singing this song. And her mum was wise enough to say to her, that was the Holy Spirit moving. It's like a mirror of heaven. You know, we get so wrapped up in the joyousness, the wonder, the ability to actually say something that is of worth to God, to bow before his throne, to listen to his voice, to feel the touch of his hand. It is these things which we will experience day by day, minute by minute, moment by moment, when we're gathered around the throne. But until that time, we can experience them here. Or at least we can see a reflection of them here, like we see a reflection in a mirror. If you read Revelation chapter 4, about what worship looks like in heaven, it's full of fervor. It's not half-hearted. There's all sorts of old hymns and new songs for that matter which have choruses in them that are sort of like meant to stir us to great heights of fervor in our worship. And sometimes we manage to do that, and other times it's more like, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. And that is not fervor, can I say? But neither is belting it out at such a pitch that you deafen everybody around you without actually feeling it. You see, fervor is nothing to do with your volume. It's about where it has its roots in your heart. When you sing something, even if you can't hold a note in a bucket, it doesn't matter. If you sing something for all your worth, with every fiber of your being singing those words of praise to God, That is what fervour is. At least that's something to do with it. When we worship before God with something approaching that same sort of fervour, that intensity, that understanding that we're singing words of truth about God, about ourselves, who we are before God, then it becomes a moment where the gap between us and heaven becomes very thin indeed. Some people talk about thin places, where the space between earth and heaven is very thin. You can almost just reach out and touch it. And I think we find those thin places sometimes in our acts of worship together, where we seem to be transported to a different place, that transport of delight into that heavenly place. And in that picture in the book of Revelation, the praise of God is ceaseless. It's never ending. And so our praise, our worship of God needs to mimic that, needs to copy that, needs to have that as our example. Our praise of God needs to be without ceasing. And that needs to be in any situation. And that's quite a tough call, isn't it? That can be an incredibly tough call. Sometimes when you're in the deep dark of despair, it's hard to sing a praise to God. There's a band called Casting Crowns. If you've not come across them, look them up. They've got some fantastic songs, really great songs. And one of their very early songs was called Praise Him in the Dance. And it's a really joyful song of praise of God. I'm dancing with delight because I'm praising God. And a few years later, they wrote another song called Praise Him in the Storm. And those two things need to go together. They both have to be true. They both have to be our song. I praise God in the dance, but I also praise Him in the storm. You see, that's not about ignoring what is happening around us. That is about claiming the things of heaven here and now. You see, I know God, you're a God of peace. I do not feel peace, so I'm going to sing about your peace. I know, God, that you're a God of freedom and liberation. I feel bound and restricted, so I'm going to sing about your freedom and your liberation. Do you see how that works? As we sing those truths about God, they become part of our reality because we're worshipping in spirit and truth. It's not a wistful hope. It's a declaration. It's a way of participating in God's redemptive power. Singing those songs of praise, whether it be an old hymn or a new song, doesn't matter. Whatever speaks truth about God, about over our current circumstances, is what it's all about. Remember the other week I was talking about when we're walking around the village or wherever you live and declaring that Jesus is Lord over this place? It's the same sort of deal. That's an act of praise. And we're declaring something which is ultimately true, but which is yet maybe to be revealed here on earth. It is ultimately true. One day every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. One day every knee will bow. We sang that earlier on. That is the truth. That is what is going to be. And sometimes is now. Our acts of worship need to serve to remind us of who God is and who we are to Him. And again, those songs do that very powerfully for us. I'm focusing quite a bit on songs this morning. That isn't the only aspect of worship that we've got going on by any stretch of the imagination, but I think it's a good place to begin. It helps me in any ways in that sort of way. It's important that we focus on aspects of God such as His majesty, His power, His love, His grace, His humility, His sacrifice. And all those things that talk about who God is, we need to declare those But then we also need to declare, I'm his son, or I'm his daughter. I'm loved by him. He cherishes me for just who I am. Because you see, that is no less true than God is a God of majesty, of power, of love, of grace, of humility, of sacrifice, and all those other things that we want to say to him. And the two hold together. Who he is and who we are in his sight, they are inseparable. You see, you can't have a saviour without somebody who needs saving. Otherwise, the saviour is redundant. You can't have a God of love without somebody who needs loving. You can't have a God of peace without people or places that are without peace. You need those things in order to be, in order for them to be realized. Up until then, they're just words, or up until then, they're just notions. And so our worship, our declaration of all these things, is about understanding that we can have a significant impact as worshippers of God. Some years ago, one of the churches I was at, a chap there, his mother died quite unexpectedly during the week, and it was perhaps on Wednesday or Thursday of the week when she died, and he came to church on the Sunday morning, and he said it was a real struggle to actually come to church that Sunday morning. And we were singing a couple of songs. I seem to remember one was the one that we've sung a number of times of Lament, which is about God restoring wasted years and comforting us in that time of lament. And we were singing that song. And we sang another song that spoke to him. But he couldn't actually sing any of these songs. He was all choked up. But everybody else was singing all these songs. And they were singing them to God, but they were also singing them over him. They didn't necessarily know that was what they were doing, but that's how he described it afterwards, that the congregation together, the people of God, his brothers and sisters who loved him dearly, were singing over him. Isn't that powerful? When we are worshipping together, whether it be our singing or any other aspect of our worship, we are not just doing this from us to God in a slight dutiful way, or even in a loving way, even in a greatly devoted way. We are doing it for each other as well. Because sometimes we haven't got the strength ourselves to worship God. We're empty. Or whatever it might be. And we need that person sat next to us. We need that person on the opposite side of the room to uphold us in that moment. To be singing those songs of praise and worship over us. To be praying on our behalf because we haven't got the ways of praying at the moment. And so it goes. Worship is also a proclamation. We ought to preach the gospel in church more than we do. Because, very generally, we all know the story, don't we? We all know the story. So why do we need to preach it? Well, because it is a public declaration of what we believe. It also reminds us what we believe. Because sometimes we do have a tendency to forget a little bit or to wander away from those central tenets, those truths of our faith, what we believe, who Jesus is, who we are, and all that sort of thing. And so it is about revisiting this cherished story. If you If you read stories with children, especially very young children, they want to read the same story over and over again. Have you ever noticed that? Our Luca has this little book called Tap Tap, and it's about these different noises that are happening, and it's one of these flat books that you open up and you discover what the noise is. And he went through this phase a few weeks ago where he just wanted to read this book over and over again. And I'd say to him, go and get Tap Tap, and he would come trotting over with his book, or he'd come over with it, and we'd sit together and we'd read this book, usually about 6 or 7 times in one sitting. And that is the sort of aspect that we need to adopt with the story of who God is, of what God has done for us. Don't just say, yes, I know the story. Let's listen to the story over and over again. Let's remind ourselves about what it is. Because you see, remembering that story helps fan the flame of faith. It helps build that fire that was sparked within us when we first believed. The Jews have a saying, which is, to forget is to die. If we forget the story of what God has done for us, then we die as a people of God. So when we consider all that worship is and all that it should be, I think we're left in no doubt that it should not be safe, it should not be predictable, where anything might happen, where we give room, space to God through his Holy Spirit to stir us, to disturb us even, to excite us. Yes, to comfort as well, and probably so many other things. But give him that space to do what only God can do. To enter in the presence of the living God in worship ought to be a highly dangerous enterprise. Probably not a good idea, but it'd be great to have a sign on the door, wouldn't it, saying, you know, enter at your own risk. I'm not sure it works well as a sort of like a, you know, a missiological statement, but you know, there needs to be that sort of sense here. Enter at your own risk, but have no fear, because God is here. It ought to be dangerous, highly dangerous, when we consider the awesome holiness of God, his majesty, his power. And all these things can and do break into our experience, into our lives, as we worship God. And then we turn those experiences back to him in praise and worship again. And we tell about how we've noticed God in our daily lives. So let's do that, shall we? Where have you noticed God this week? I've sprung this on you quite quickly this week, so I'll tell you this fabulous story from Open the Book on Thursday. It was absolutely brilliant, wasn't it, Francis? We were telling the story of Palm Sunday, and normally the children sit in sort of like 5 or 6 rows, all facing the front. But this time we had them in 3 rows facing the back, 3 rows facing the front, with a big gap down the middle, and that was going to be our parade for Palm Sunday down the middle. And some of them had palm branches. The teachers chose the sensible ones to hold palm branches, and some of them had strips of material and so on to wave. And Jesus had a donkey that he was riding on, and some of the children were disciples falling behind. And there was a fervor there, wasn't there? It did get to like a fever pitch sort of moment. And as the story finished, I think it was probably one of the adults in the ensemble started just fairly quietly, sort of like shouting, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And all of a sudden, all these children were all shouting, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And it was like, I thought a riot was going to break out any minute now. But it was ecstatic. So excited. And there was one little girl, and I just noticed her. And she, even though she was sat down, she was bouncing up and down, shouting, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. So, yes, God certainly turned up on Thursday at Open the Book. Where have you noticed God recently?
I'm not sure I follow that. My eyes just welled up with tears and I heard that. I might not be the only one in the room. To think of the children. It makes all the prayer we do worthwhile, doesn't it, when we hear stories like this. And in fact, I'm going to tell you something different from what I'd planned. And it was something I was reminded of. Something God spoke to me a long, long time ago before the Holy Spirit had kind of come and broken me open a bit. And I was classically trained as a pianist, although you might not think it now, because I don't play a bit like I used to. And I developed a friendship with this girl. And we'd never been in church together, but I went to visit her church. And we sat on the front row, which I wouldn't normally have done, but Helen liked that, so that was what we did. And then somebody started playing. It was a Pentecostal church. And this girl erupted in praise. And I'd never seen anything like it. And she was completely out of tune. It was before the Holy Spirit got hold of me. And inside, in that moment, I was thinking, well, you could have given me a friend who sang in tune. And I don't think I've ever felt so rebuked. If you think you can't sing a note in a bucket, God, it was like he just went, I like it. So that's what I want to say. He likes it.
Brilliant. Yeah, thank you. Anybody else? Form an orderly queue. Let me move this forward a bit. Give you room.
I have to mention Strictly last night. I just see God every single time, and it's just the talent that we have in this church, and it's talent that's used in the right way, and it's just awesome. But I've also got to admit, I've got to say something about Evie this morning. When she was dancing away, and it was beautiful, to the worship songs this morning, it was just, I had tears then.
Mine is sort of the reverse of last night, where it was a lot of praising and worship and people singing and the band playing wonderfully, which is all true, they were. But I was going to say, I joined the house group that Lyndon and Francis run, or Bible study rather than the house group, on a Tuesday night when we started it back in September, I think it was. And I'll be honest, I've never been to a Bible study like that before, which is very bad, given how old I am, but anyway. And it is just a wonderful thing. And I was sat there on Tuesday night, and it just felt very special, and I just felt God was with us in the room, and has been on previous occasions, but I just felt it particularly this week. We've grown as a group, we get to know each other, and it's very good, the sort of the study that we're doing. So I just wanted to share that with you.
Thank you. On that note, if you're Steve, are you coming? Yeah. On that note, if you're not part of a house group or a Bible study group and you want to know more, then they are listed in the notices So have a look at what's there. Talk to people. You'll find out who goes to which groups and so on, and you'd be very welcome at any of them. Steve.
Hello.
Come to the microphone, mate.
Yes. Yeah. On a Saturday, I usually take the papers out to my sister at Southstoke, and routine. Anyway, I went out with my car yesterday to get the papers, and I went down to Southstoke, and I went down, and I thought I'd get down and get up, no trouble at all. I got halfway down and realised what I'd done the wrong thing. And I went along the road and I got stuck and I managed to turn round and I thought, whatever am I going to do? Sue's going to blow her top when I get home. Not to mention all the rest. Anyway, I was there wondering what to do, and there was these young families with their children, and they come from nowhere, and they had grit. They were throwing down grit, and they had shovels, and I thought they were going to tell me to get whatever, and we took three attempts, and managed to get up, and they said, go, and I got up on the top, and I had some money for the papers, and I had some over, and I went down, and I said, look, I said, you must have this, God bless you all, because without you, I'd been in a right state, because I would have been, and they said, you put it to in a charity, whatever. So I said, well, I should do that tomorrow morning when we go to church. But I was in it right, I did whatever, and they just come from nowhere, and the Lord does work.
Absolutely. Yeah.
People mock me, but I don't give a hoot what they say, any of them.
Well said. Well said. Brilliant. Let's pray together, shall we? Father God, just to be able to call you Father is wonderful in itself, because it also speaks about who we are before your sight. Precious children, loved by you, loved beyond any doubt whatsoever. Your eyes upon each one of us. You care for us. You have a care for us. And so we bring you our prayers this morning. We pray for those who find themselves without a home, without a roof over their heads. And unlike us who can find a place to get warm again, it might be a long time before they feel the warmth. We pray, Lord, that we pray for justice for them, whether it be justice for mental health, whether it be justice for social circumstance or financial circumstance. May our society seek to bring justice to each of these. And may that start with ours, with us, Lord. Change our hearts so that the hearts of those who have the power to make change would also be changed. Thank you for those who do whatever they can to bring relief to others. And we pray for all those who slept out on Friday night and for their efforts. And we pray that the money raised would make such a great difference in the lives of others, bringing them hope, bringing them new life. Lord, we pray for those whom we know within our own communities, our own neighborhoods, who are in need. Those who are sick and suffering. We give you thanks, Lord, for the answers to prayers that we've seen over these last few weeks. Especially we're so thankful that Beryl is home. Well, thank you too that Helen is back home with her family. We pray for continued recovering for both of them and for others who we've been praying for. Lord, we thank you that you have blessed us through this gathering here today, this messy breakfast. And for all those who've come to find something of you here in this place, even if they don't know that's what they're looking for. May they have found the Saviour Jesus here this morning. Lord, we ask you to bless our communities in which we live, the neighbourhoods, the streets where we live. We pray a blessing upon our neighbours. Keep us, O Lord, a people of praise and worship each and every day with our eyes focused upon you, so that your goodness, your mercy, your love may be realized in our lives, but also in the lives of those whom we meet. We ask your blessing on our homes and our families, those whom we love. May each know the peace of Christ reigning in their hearts and their lives day by day. And it is in Jesus' name that we offer our prayers. Amen. So we're going to sing again, and as we do, going to hopefully get everybody else back in with us, and then we'll find out what's been going on out there. Let's stand together.
Thank you.
Well, could certainly hear everybody coming back in with all sorts of shakers, and we've got mouth organs and all sorts of things. Fantastic. Right, well, we better have a look at all these. Harmonicas. Fantastic. Right. Okay, where shall we start then? Where shall we start? Who wants to demonstrate something? Right, okay, let's have all the shakers. All the shakers. Stand up with your shakers. And on the count of three, let's give a big shake. Ready? One, two, three, shake. And stop. Fantastic. Right, have we got pan pipes? Pan pipes, all right. Pan pipes on the count of three. Ready? One, two, three. Oh. Keep going, keep going. Can you hear that?
Yes.
Fantastic. Those are great. The pan pipes are hard work, I think. Right. Who's got a mouth organ? Right, let's hear the mouth organ. Fantastic. Right. That's wonderful. Right. Stop. Brilliant. All right. So, and why have you made all these things? Why have you made them?
Praise God.
To praise God, right, to help us to praise God. There's all sorts of things in the Bible. There's a psalm that talks about praising God with all sorts of different instruments. And some of them might be some of these things. I don't think the harmonica's in there. But anyways, don't worry about that. Praise God with all sorts of instruments. Right, so what's this here? Who's going to tell us what this is? Right, come and tell us. Which temple is it?
The temple of God.
In Jerusalem?
Yeah.
Fantastic. So this is, so did you see a model of it?
Yes.
A picture, and this is, and you made it just like that?
No.
Nearly.
Yeah.
You put your own interpretation on it. Good. Well done. That's fantastic, isn't it? So this is a model of what the temple might have looked like when Jesus went and turned all the tables over. Everybody can't see it. You two have got your noggins in the way. There's what? Sorry. Oh, right. So also made some individual ones, Lego ones out there. Oh, we've got one here. Right. Come on then. So this is Chidimer, isn't it? Yes. So this is one that Chidimer's made. Okay. And there's even some people on top. Is that Jesus turning the tables over? Yeah, fantastic, brilliant. Well done. Okay, so that just leaves our graffiti thing. Right, are you two going to hold it up then? Okay, so this is what was started at Lighthouse on Thursday night. So we've got the word worship in the middle, and lots of people have written all sorts of amazing things about worship. Words of worship, what it means to be a worshiper, what we do when we come into worship. And that reminds us of some of the things that we've been talking about as well. So, fantastic. Thank you. We'll have to find... We might actually hang that on the railings outside because it's got the things on it to do that. That'd be good. All right. So, what have we been doing in here then? What have we been doing in here? Nikki, what have we been doing in here this morning? Hold on. Say that again.
David, about worship and praise, and so the same sort of thing that they've done out there, we've been listening to.
Thank you.
And we've sung on praise too.
Yeah. Well, that's part of the answer I wanted. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. What have we been doing in here this morning, Caroline? What have we been doing this morning?
Listening to you.
I know. We've had that answer already.
No, you're getting better, David. I'm very impressed.
And the battery's not run out on this yet. Come on. Any more words of wisdom?
No, that'll do for today.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, you're right. It will do. See you, me. I don't need to come here to be insulted, you know. Lots of lots of other places I could go. All right, fantastic. All right, so what some of us were doing before service this morning at breakfast, you were given a piece of paper with all sorts of words on it to do with worship, and Nick and Ian have been putting all those words, they've been counting them up, and they've made a word cloud for us to have a look at, and there it is now. Okay, so if you're familiar with word clouds, you'll know that the bigger the word, that is what most people said. So the smallest words, can't read some of those small ones, all right, sorry, dad, faith, oh, hold on. Thank you. I had my eyes tested on Thursday, you know. Yeah, all right, so you can see all the smaller words. Those are the ones that people didn't say very much. But if we could go to the big picture again. Zoom back out again. So the ones that people focused on most were praise, praying, singing, Jesus. And then the words start to get a bit smaller together, presence, majesty, holy. And so you can see what we're saying together when we're thinking about worship and those words that mean something to us about worship. I wonder if we could get this in the next lot of notices. Would that go in, do you think? We could do that, and then everybody can see it, can't they? Take it away with them. Oh, yeah, put it on Facebook. Excellent. Fantastic. What should we do now? Let's take up the offertory now, shall we? Yes. Who's got the bags this morning? Who's got the offertory bags? Right, quick. Go and take the bags round. Who's got the other ones? They're all over here. Right. Come over this. That's right. Go up that side. Is there another one somewhere? It'd be funny if you get your tongue stuck in there, wouldn't it? That's really good, is that? You still got your chocolate. Don't hold this for me when everybody comes and puts the money in it. Come on then, stand up. Here then, show that and they'll come and put the bags of money in. And you stand here. No, just wait for them to come to you. Oh, thank you. Has everybody used it? Has everybody used it? What do you do? What do you do? Yeah. After practice. Brilliant. Right, we've got all our opportunity. Let's have everybody, all the harmonicas quiet for a minute. Just turn around. You're right. Is it too heavy? Okay. Let's go. We're going to pray now. Lord, we thank you for all this, all the good gifts that you give to us. And we give you these gifts of money to represent our thankful hearts. Help this money to be used in through this church so that the love of Jesus may be known by many people across this village. And so in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Just put it down there, see. Let's say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Thank you. Right, I've been given my own harmonica here, so I'll have to practice that, see if I can get a tune out of it. Does anybody want to hear a joke about harmonica before we finish today? Well done. Good answer, Fred. All right. So this mouse goes into a music shop, and it says to the man in the music shop, I'm looking for a mouth organ. And the man in the music shop says, well, that's funny, another mouse was in here early on asking for the same thing. And the mouse said, oh, yeah, that would be harmonica. All right, let's...
You need to explain that harmonica and mouth organ are the same thing.
Yeah, you can use that one, all right. If you... let's finish... praising God and singing. And if you've made your own musical instrument, then join in. Shake your shakers, blow your mouth organs, blow your pan pipes, wave your streamers, and don't forget to sing as well. And so now may the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forevermore. Amen.